Today's episode of Escape from Walt Disney is brought to you by the Godiva Chocolates Goldmark Collection. That's right, just in time for the 10th anniversary of my web series, Some Jerk with a Camera, the Godiva Chocolate Company has seen fit to name some of their boxes of chocolates after me, Tony Goldmark. How cool is that? The Godiva Goldmark Collection combines legendary chocolate craftsmanship with creatively modernized techniques and recipes. Their exceptional chocolates are guaranteed to delight with every bite, with flavors that are uniquely Godiva and irresistibly delicious. Let me talk you through it. First, there's the Godiva Goldmark Assorted Chocolates Collection. Enjoy an exciting variety of unique flavors and textures, including milk chocolate hazelnut heaven, dark chocolate raspberry velvet, and white chocolate sugar, just to name a few. Ooh, don't those sound good? There's also the Goldmark Chocolate Caramels Collection. Savor these milk chocolates and dark chocolates with exquisite caramel fillings, including velvety vanilla caramel and rich dark chocolate caramel for the discerning caramel lover. The Godiva Goldmark Collection is made for enjoying on your own, sharing with friends, or gifting. Hey, Valentine's Day is coming up, folks, and nothing says I love you like the gift of Goldmark. And speaking of holidays, they also apparently had Godiva Goldmark holiday boxes available at Christmas time, but it's not Christmas time anymore, so I don't know why I told you that. You know, I've always thought that the randomizer we use here on Escape from Walt Disney is kind of like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're gonna get. Except on weeks like this one, when we set the randomizer aside and do a more gimmicky episode, I'm getting off track. You can find the Godiva Goldmark Collection in the chocolate aisle of your favorite retailer, or even your very least favorite, why not? And I am beyond honored to have my name associated with such superior confectionery. In fact, I'm pretty sure this means the Willy Wonka prequel is about me now. My golden ticket must have gotten lost in the mail or something. Or maybe my Goldmark ticket, who knows? I knew having such a Jewy last name would pay off eventually. You can learn more about Godiva's Goldmark collection by Googling Godiva Goldmark. You're gonna have to Google it, I'm afraid, since for some reason the Goldmark collection is not on the drop-down menu of Godiva's website, and it's not to be confused with the Godiva Gold collection. That bullshit can fuck off to hell. That's only half my last name. You kidding me with that shit? That's the Goldmark collection from Godiva. Legendary craftsmanship, delightful chocolates. Okay, full disclosure, Godiva didn't actually pay me to do this spot or even ask me to do it, and apparently they've been slapping Goldmark on some of their boxes for over a year now, but I just learned about it, dammit, and the chocolates literally got my name on it. I wasn't gonna not bring it up, but as long as I've got your attention, be sure to keep listening through the end of this episode for a special announcement about the near future of this podcast and how you can help choose what we cover next month.
Hey, Barry, dinner's ready.
Barry Barrington was like any other boy.
Sometimes I feel different. Like Dex and me, we don't look the same. He has freckles, and I don't. I think.
He was loved by his parents.
Just remember, son, the people who love you no matter what, that's your family.
And sometimes his brother.
This is my baby picture, and this is yours.
Mom, am I adopted?
Of course not, honey.
Dexter!
I gotta face facts. I just don't fit in.
He's run away from home.
You knew you were gonna have to release him into the wild one day.
Now Barry's about to discover his destiny.
The Country Band!
With four guys who are barely a band.
I belong here.
Welcome aboard, kid.
You're one of us, man.
Well, are you going to find him?
Does he have any distinguishing marks?
Yeah,
he's got thick brown hair all over his body.
You guys, they're right behind us.
How about a little thing I call hiding in the car wash?
So how does that work?
We hide in the car wash.
Where'd he go?
Your hair looks ridiculous.
My hair.
From Walt Disney Pictures. One boy is searching for what he's been missing.
You're gonna do the show?
Not without you.
And discovering what he's had all along.
Who's that little bear?
Oh, that's no little bear. That's my
Disney's The Country Bears.
Yeah.
To all who come to this happy place, welcome one and all to our very special Some Jerk with a Camera 10th anniversary episode of Escape from Walt Disney, the podcast where we review movies, TV shows, and short films available on the Disney Plus streaming service, usually chosen completely at random. I'm Some Jerk with a Camera, aka your host, Tony Goldmark. Can you believe it's been a whopping 10 fucking years since I first released the very first episode of my theme park-centric comedy web series, Some Jerk with a Camera? God, we're old. We're all really, really old. Look how old we are.
What? Speak up, sonny.
And to celebrate our oldness, we are gonna do a big ol' self-indulgent special episode of this podcast commemorating this cosmically important milestone. Joining me today via Zoom are three of my very best friends and closest collaborators in the whole wretched world. All the way from Anaheim, California, he's been arguably the single biggest supporter of my work in all the years I've been doing it, David Ganssle.
It's actually just my stuffed head mounted on the wall.
And we've also got two very close friends who've been with me almost since the very beginning, all the way from Riverside, California, Morgan Funder. And all the way from Simi Valley, California, Charlie Callahan.
I'm going to showcase just a little bit more excitement than that. Yay.
I meant it in a loving way. I mean,
it was loving exasperation.
It's been 10 fucking years, guys.
It's been a lot in the last four. What are we talking about?
And because the very first episode of Some Jerk with a Camera, released on blip.tv on February 3rd, 2011, was a review of the Country Bears movie, this week we are setting the randomizer aside just temporarily and revisiting that seminal 2002 cinematic classic. Now, like I said, because this is the big Some Jerk 10th anniversary special, this is going to be a much more self-indulgent, navel-gazy podcast than we usually do here, and podcasts by nature are already pretty self-indulgent, so if you don't even know who we are and you just stumbled across this episode because you were looking for some Country Bears content for whatever reason, then I highly recommend you skip to the 34-minute mark in this episode, because that's where we're really going to start talking about the movie itself as opposed to just my video about it. Once again, if you want to skip all the autobiographical ramblings and get straight to us talking about the movie, skip to the 34-minute mark in this podcast, okay? Okay.
It must be Disney magic.
Yeah, it must be.
The wrong video.
Sorry. Yeah, that's true, right?
We're celebrating the 10th anniversary of the show in general. We can throw in whatever in-jokes we want.
Ketchup?
Ketchup!
Ketchup, indeed. It's like a K-Tel record up in here. So, unfortunately, you can't really talk about the origins of Some Jerk with a Camera without talking about a fellow by the name of Doug Walker and his flagship series, The Nostalgia Critic. And I say unfortunately because, as many of my listeners already know, Mr. Walker, and especially the company that employs him, Channel Awesome, have become somewhat controversial figures among people who watch that kind of content in recent years. Now, I'm not going to defend anything they've done. There's a reason I'm not on the side anymore, let's just put it that way. But I don't want to dwell on it too much either, because frankly, it's off-topic and not very pleasant, but regardless of all that, the fact does remain that without the Nostalgia Critic, there just would not have been a Some Jerk with a Camera. When the Nostalgia Critic came along, it was kind of a revelation to me. I had made a few videos in college, some of which you can still find at the very, very deepest depths of my YouTube channel if you scroll all the way down. I was very proud of them at the time. I thought they were great. They weren't, but I thought they were great, and their failure to go viral and become the next Smosh, basically
2007 YouTube, what a time.
The failure of them basically discouraged me from doing any more of them for a while, and then in 2008, I moved to Los Angeles in the hopes of becoming a TV writer, but that wasn't really happening for me at the time, and ultimately, I think I knew deep down that I didn't really want to be a TV writer. I didn't want to just write a script and hand it off to someone else. I wanted creative autonomy over what I wrote, all the way down to the final edit. I wanted to produce something that I could honestly say was fully mine, even if it was just some crummy little internet video that no one saw. And around that time, I discovered this crummy little internet video series that a lot of people saw called The Nostalgia Critic. And like millions of people, I saw what he was doing and said, hey, I can do that.
The rest of us on this podcast are among those who saw what he was doing and said, we can do that.
Yes, exactly.
Ooh, yeah.
It was approachable in a way that a lot of online comedy sort of wasn't at the time.
It was doable.
Yeah.
He was clearly filming this show in his parents' house for dirt cheap, but he had creative autonomy, he didn't have to answer to anyone, and for as objectively not that great as most of those videos were, they did have a certain youthful DIY energy about them that a lot of us gravitated towards. It was like how a million shitty garage bands must have felt when they first heard Louie Louie. That sounds like crap. I could definitely do that.
I too can suck.
I know I'm at least as good as that guy.
With this format Doug Walker had devised, you could take pre-existing content and make fun of it, kinda like MST3K and Riff Tracks, but they always had to think up jokes for an entire movie, whereas with the Nostalgia Critic format, you could just skip through the movie to where the joke ideas were. And it wasn't even so much what Doug was doing with the format as the potential I could see of what could be done with it. It always felt to me like Doug was stopping short of doing something really exciting with these videos, of really having fun with it and playing around with them. Now, another interesting aspect of all this is that at the time, YouTube's copyright system was way more stringent than it is today. They were blocking videos and striking channels, including Doug's, left and right for just having material that used copyrighted material. Whereas today, those measures are much more of a last resort because they have the infrastructure in place to claim monetization rather than take down your video entirely. And, you know, claiming monetization is a whole other issue on its own, but that's neither here nor there. The point is, because people like Doug Walker, whose work depended on fair use copyright laws, were getting kicked off of YouTube, instead they all converged on an alternative video hosting site called Blip.tv. One of the upsides of Blip is they really didn't give a shit about copyright, like, at all.
Nope.
They claimed they did, because I think legally they had to claim they did, but as long as you weren't uploading entire movies, they pretty much left you alone.
They also had a more transparent monetization system.
Absolutely,
oh, yeah.
Which was not really something that YouTube had at the time.
Those of us who to this day had AdSense issues could make a home on Blip.
But one of the downsides of Blip is that on its own, it didn't have that much of a sense of community. The channels were very insular. You'd watch someone's video on Blip, and then instantly it would direct you to the next video that person made. It didn't do a lot of suggestions of other videos you might like.
There was a feature where the channel creator could recommend channels.
Right, right. We got to recommend our own other videos.
I forgot about that part of it.
If you could curate your own YouTube recommendations, can you imagine?
And that was a neat feature for the creators, certainly, but from the viewer's point of view, I do think that still felt a little insular.
Yeah, Blip was always chasing this viewership audience, but it never really found that as a website. The only real audience it found was aspiring video creators.
To fill this void, Doug Walker started a website, thatguywiththeglasses.com, later rebranded channelawesome.com, which hosted not only Nostalgia Critic and his other videos, but was also starting to cultivate lots of new talent from other similar creators who were contributing to this aggregate site. People like Linkara and Mars Girl and Kyle Kalgren and Lindsay Ellis and Filmbrain and Mike J and Todd in the Shadows and Spoony and Angry Joe and Brad Jones, people like that. And it really was this tight-knit little community of video makers that was kind of separate from the YouTube machine. I know Haley's referred to it as Madagascar because it's all these strange creatures who got to evolve on their own without influence from the mainland. Every year they'd collaborate on a big, increasingly elaborate anniversary special where they'd all converge in one place and shoot a makeshift low-budget movie. And from the outside looking in, it looked like everyone involved was having a shitload of fun. Turns out they weren't, but it looked like they were. There was lots of drama going on behind the scenes as it happened.
Hindsight is last year.
But anyway, these people, to one degree or another, were all on some level adapting the Nostalgia Critic review format to other media. What the Nostalgia Critic did to movies, the other producers were doing to TV, or video games, or comic books, or music. But I noticed, no one, or at least no one that I was noticing, we'll get to you, Charlie. No one was doing theme parks, or at least no one on that guy with the glasses that I could find. And no one on YouTube was really making narrative videos about theme parks at that time either. Now, this was before Defunctland, before Yesterworld Entertainment, before theme park history. Nowadays, there's a million in-park vloggers all making YouTube channels. We're just bombarded with channels about theme parks and that content, all of which have about 50 times more subscribers than me, but I'm not bitter. And it was also before I learned that Charlie here had actually done some theme park videos before I managed to. I'm sure you can speak to that, and Will.
What? Oh, me?
Yes.
I didn't make theme park videos before you.
Of course you did. Don't be modest.
I just had this review show where I was basically reviewing anything I liked, one of which happened to be theme parks, specifically my top 20 favorite rides at Disneyland, which is available on my channel. Which one? I forget at the moment.
If you want to see little baby Charlie.
Who didn't know what he was doing, didn't know what ADR meant.
God damn it, he's got a tripod and a dream.
But yeah, like those videos had come out, I want to say June and July of 2010, which was wrapping up my second season of videos, because I had started like in 2008. And then all of a sudden, I'm notified of this one creator who was featured in a show that I was a part of, which is another story we won't get into.
Another thing we don't have to get into.
And the host of the show said, "Sorry, Charlie, there's a new game in town, and it's this guy called Some Jerk with a Camera who's doing a video about the Country Bears movie at Disneyland."
Well, let me back up from that just a bit. Like I said, I couldn't find any major people on thatguywiththeglasses.com who were doing theme park videos, and I thought this was a void I could fill. My first major purchase after moving to LA had been a Disneyland annual pass. Remember annual passes, kids? Those were neat. I've been a huge fan of the place ever since I was a kid. I always wanted to be in a position where I could go whenever I wanted. Now that I lived in LA, I could. But the problem is, I ended up going so often that I kind of got sick of the place. I went to the park so frequently that I was starting to get bored riding the same damn rides over and over again, and I thought maybe if I make videos about it, that'll reinvigorate my interest in it. And by filming on location at the parks themselves, I could give the videos a lot more visual flair than just some dude jibber-jabbering in front of a white wall, like all the other Nostalgia Critic wannabes were. I pretty quickly decided that I wanted my first video to be a Nostalgia Critic-style review of the 2002 Country Bears movie, because I wasn't exactly sure whether reviewing theme parks in this format would even work, and I thought, well, if I start with a movie, at least there's a roadmap there that I can follow before I move on to something weirder and more offbeat. And also, I was just fascinated by the fact that that movie existed, and that it was the first ever theatrical movie based on a Disneyland attraction. Before any of the Pirates movies, before the Eddie Murphy Haunted Mansion movie, before Brad Bird's Tomorrowland, before the upcoming Jungle Cruise with The Rock, there was the Country Bears, this doomed, disastrous, awkward, completely inexplicable mess of a children's movie with these horrible-looking bear suits where they somehow got Christopher Walken to play the villain. If you're a fan of weird, bad, early 2000s movies, and who isn't?
Of course.
It's the stuff dreams are made of. And also, the Nostalgia Critic hadn't really covered the Country Bears yet. He since has. He did a whole video on it a couple years ago, but up to that point, the only time he had ever really talked about it was when it was one of the entries in a video he made called The Top 11 Most Awkward Christopher Walken Moments, but he hadn't done the whole movie, so it seemed like fair game. And I'm not exaggerating on this. I spent a year off and on writing the script of that first video. I'm pretty sure I spent significantly longer on my script of the review than the writer spent on their script of the movie. And I decided to call myself Some Jerk with a Camera kind of as a play on that guy with the glasses, because at the end of the day, everyone making internet videos is just some jerk with a camera. That was my sort of meta commentary on doing this shit in the first place. Finally, in January 2011, I thought, okay, this thing is ready to shoot now, and I filmed the damn thing in 2 days. I spent one day at the park by myself just getting various bits of B-roll and a few shots of myself here and there where I didn't need anyone else to hold the camera, like me on Dumbo holding the camera like a selfie. And then another day, getting all the shots of myself on camera where I did need a camera person, and the camera person in question was an old friend of mine named Vicky DeVries, who I knew from the Weird Al fandom. In fact, her big claim to fame in the Weird Al fandom is that she and Dave Elvis Rossi were the two people most principally responsible for getting Weird Al his star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame.
Oh, that's cool.
I corralled her into being my camera person because she was literally the only person I knew in SoCal at the time who had a Disneyland annual pass and weekdays free.
Well, that sure changed.
I filmed using this shitty flip cam. Remember flip cams, kids?
Oh, yeah. Yes, I had one. I got one because of you.
Ah, before phones had good cameras.
It was this tiny little pocket-sized rectangular camera. It simultaneously fit in your pocket and really didn't comfortably fit in your pocket. It ran on two AA batteries. It shot in 720p. The audio quality was just awful and tinny. Half the time I had to ADR the audio later. And rather embarrassingly, I used that same flip cam way longer than I should have. Like, I shot everything in the first two seasons of Some Jerk with a Camera with that dumb little flip cam. And like you said, nowadays most people's phones can shoot in better quality, but, you know, it was convenient for me. It enabled me to get the shots I needed quickly and expediently. I practically had that damn thing on a holster, and that was good enough for me at the time. Similarly, I edited the video on Windows Movie Maker, which also shows how long ago this was, because again, it was cheap and convenient for me, and I learned to work around the software's limitations.
I remember you confidently declaring in the Tigwatig forums how you made Windows Movie Maker your bitch.
Yep, I most certainly did.
It was thoroughly charming.
So I banged this thing into shape, and then finally, on February 3rd, 2011, I released it on my newly formed Blip channel, somejerkwithacamera.blip.tv. Now, at that point, I had kind of missed the boat on becoming a site contributor, at least at the time. They weren't really accepting new talent anymore in 2011, but they did have forums on thatguywiththeglasses.com, or Tigwatig, as we'd often call them. And they had a whole sub-forum for Nostalgia Critic wannabes, people who wanted to do what Doug and the rest were doing, to post their own videos and see what kind of a reaction they'd get. Now, I had never posted in these forums at all. I'd never even commented on anything. The first thing I ever posted in the Tigwatig forums was my link to this newly completed Country Bears video that I'd done, without anyone knowing about it except me and Vicky. And I distinctly remember the first comment I got on it. It was from someone whose real name is Michael Bennett, but at the time he was doing a Nostalgia Critic knockoff series centered around a character he created named Phil Bunny, a little rabbit puppet he had who looked a lot like Max from Sam and Max, and Phil Bunny would go on to make several cameos throughout Some Jerk Seasons 1 and 2. He's the rabbit puppet who shows up sometimes.
People in Florida always misuse the word literally. That literally makes my head explode every
time. That episode was 15 months ago. Have you been bitching about Florida this whole time?
No, every so often I bitch about Glee for 10 minutes.
But the guy behind him, Michael Bennett, at the time, he fancied himself, and these are his words, the Gordon Ramsay of the Tigwatig forums. I'm not kidding. He would go through everyone's videos on the wannabe subforum and give them what he perceived as brutally honest feedback. And I do mean brutally honest. If he thought someone had no talent and shouldn't be doing this, he'd tell them, you have no talent and shouldn't be doing this. He was frankly kind of a dick about it. But you know, not to say that this is worth him being a dick to everyone, but the flip side of that is that when he actually gives you a compliment, you know it's genuine. You know he's not just being nice. And his comment on my video was something along the lines of, holy fucking shit, dude, you rock. This video is awesome. Can we be friends, like, immediately?
Yes, I remember that.
And a few others on the forum, including present company, were echoing the same sentiments. And, you know, delicate creative egos being what they are, if I hadn't gotten that positive reinforcement right off the bat, I might not have done a second video. It all probably would have just fallen by the wayside. And honestly, watching that first video now, it's a little rough around the edges. The audio in particular leaves much to be desired, but overall, it holds up pretty well, if I do say so myself.
I remember that entirely new account dropping the Country Bears video, and what made it stand out is, yes, we all did reviews, but some people were more into the themes, or some people were just do what the Nostalgia Critic did and just make a lot of snarky jokes. you had actual comedy writing chops, and they showed. That 20-minute video is so packed with jokes. They come so fast and so hard. It never slows down. Those 20 minutes just fly by.
It's definitely the Zucker Brothers school of quality through quantity. Just pounding you with so many jokes one after another. Oh, you didn't like that one? Well, here's another one in 2 seconds.
Kind of. What got me about it is that it felt like every single second of that video had been thought about.
Some might say overthought, but...
Define overthinking.
Let's overthink overthinking.
Exactly. Its biggest weakness is that it is absolutely just me trying to ape the Nostalgia Critic format. It's mostly set up punchline, set up punchline, set up punchline for 24 minutes, and not really playing with the format as much as I would in later videos.
Right.
If I had made that thing even a year later, it would have been a very different thing.
It's a very limited format that you can be very creative within.
And there's an argument that, well, you gotta crawl before you can walk. You know, I had to make this conventional video before I made some of the weirder ones. But it does hold up a lot better than most people's first videos. And I attribute that to the fact that I was a little older than most people are when they first start. I was 27 at the time. You can do the math to figure out how old I am now. And I'd already made a bunch of videos in college, many of which will never see the light of day. So I'd kind of gotten the really bad shit out of my system early. And if you watch it on YouTube today, honestly, the most embarrassing thing about it is the intro that I filmed 3 years later, where I gush about how flattered I am to be joining the Channel Awesome family, but more on that later.
Yes.
So a few weeks after I post the video, a bunch of us in the forum had gotten as chummy as you can get with other people on a forum, and we were like, hey, those of us who live in Southern California, we should have an in-person meetup. Let's meet up in person somewhere and be like real friends and stuff. And we did, and that was the first time I ever met Charlie and Morgan. We met at the Santa Monica Promenade, and it was me, Charlie, Morgan, and Michael Bennett, aka Phil Bunny, who kind of ended up being the Pete Best of our friend group, because very shortly afterwards, he moved away from LA, and we only intermittently kept in touch with him after that. I think he's got a Twitch channel now or something, but anyway, the three of us became great friends after that, appeared in each other's videos all the time. We still remain great friends to this day. And it was sometime after that that we all became friends with Dave as well. And Dave, I'm sure you can speak to how you found us.
Well, I was also working on a theme park video, thinking nobody's really made theme park videos.
Right.
That's always how it goes.
I also spent over a year working on the first one.
You know, we're saying, oh, I spent over a year working on this video. Like, we don't still do that.
I know.
I don't know what you're talking about. I've never heard of a Blitztravafornia. In fact, at one point working on the first Dave Does Disney, I needed a clip from the Country Bears movie. At the time, I couldn't find the clip online. I don't think your video was up yet, so I checked the movie out from the library, and that was the only time I've seen the full movie, which we'll get to later.
Mm.
I was living in Florida because of this job I had, which is a whole separate, long, complicated story. And I had never been to Disney World before. I grew up visiting California, so I had been to Disneyland many times. So as soon as I got to Orlando, I got a Disney World annual pass. And I thought, oh, I should do like a silly little vlog where I react to Disney World for the first time as a Disneyland fan. And like everything I do, it just ballooned out of control and became this whole overwhelming thing. And what was supposed to be just a dinky little vlog became this 6-part series where every part is at least 15 or 20 minutes and the series is still shaping the content I make to this day. And during that year working on it, there was a lot of sunk cost mentality going into it because...
Where would we be without sunk cost mentality?
Where
Let's be real
would
here.
We be? We'd be exactly the same place that music would be without unrequited love.
Exactly.
We'd be nowhere.
I've come too far on this not to finish it, but nobody's going to care. Why am I still doing this? Eventually, I put the finishing touches on the first video. I, too, registered with the Tigwatig forums just to have a place to share it. And it was actually then that I discovered somebody on the forums made a post where they were indexing everybody who was posting shows on the forums and what the shows were about.
Huh. Yeah, I remember that.
And I clicked on that just for the ego trip of seeing, oh, I wonder if I'm mentioned in this. And I think I just hit Control F and typed Disney Parks. And to my surprise, I found I wasn't the only entry that came up for Disney parks. And that's how I found the Some Jerk with a Camera thread. But that's not how I first discovered you, Tony, because I actually recognized your name from your comedy music days.
That's right. Yeah, way back before any of this, I fancied myself a comedy musician for several years. Got a couple of pretty decent Dr. Demento hits, especially in the mid-2000s. My biggest was a parody of Sir Mix-a-Lot's Baby Got Back about Harry Potter and the Prisoner of Azkaban called Sirius Black.
I actually remember that, and that blew my mind a little bit when I finally met you.
I don't know why I thought that was a good idea, but people seemed to like it. Honestly, at the time, it was the closest thing I'd ever had to a viral hit.
Speaking of fandoms with unfortunate baggage.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
But Dave, because you were living in Florida, you were able to help me immensely on my 2012 trip to Florida to shoot all the Florida material I needed for the Epcot retrospective and the ABC Goes to Disney World retrospective.
That's right. We had communicated online prior to that. We had already begun work on the big Fantasmic collaboration.
Ooh, yeah.
Which, of course, can be found on Dave's YouTube channel, youtube.com/Doggins.
But our first time meeting in person was when you came in for that trip. You arrived in Orlando, we met in person, and we immediately went to work on 2 straight weeks of production.
Right.
And miraculously, that was actually a good way to start a friendship.
It really was, bizarrely enough. We just clicked instantly. The years continued to roll on. I put out more and more episodes. We all did. In 2014, TigWithTig announced, we're opening the site to new contributors for the first time in years. We're looking for new talent. Submit your work and see if you get accepted into our community of collaborators. I submitted my work and I got in. And starting in October 2014, I was on Channel Awesome, as it was soon rebranded. I re-uploaded all my videos from my first 2 seasons with new intros. 2015, correct me if I'm wrong, Dave, but I think that was the year you moved to California?
That is correct. At the beginning of 2015, I finally moved to California.
Join us!
So you were in town, so we got to collaborate that much more frequently. Also in 2015, Blip shut down. It was a whole fucking corporate thing where it had been bought out by Maker, and then Maker got bought out by Disney, and Disney just did not give a shit, so it was very soon no more. We all had to re-upload our back catalogs to YouTube, having lost our platform. Fortunately, by that point, YouTube had significantly relaxed its copyright process, so to this day, you can find all my old Some Jerk videos there, including the Country Bears one we've been blathering about. And another big milestone for me, at least at the time, was in 2017, when I was invited to fly to Chicago for a few days and film a co-review for The Nostalgia Critic with Doug Walker, which was a big damn deal for me at the time. We co-reviewed the 2010 Sorcerer's Apprentice movie with Nicolas Cage. And I'll tell you right now, if the randomizer ever picks that movie, that episode will be the one where I really shit-talk Doug Walker. Because I do have a lot to say about the man. I don't know if this episode is the appropriate place to say it, but if we ever cover The Sorcerer's Apprentice, that'll be my window. That'll be the place to do it.
That is the day foretold in the prophecy.
Absolutely.
Audience, you know what to do next Patreon request month.
So then, of course, in 2018, the hashtag Change the Channel movement happened. Long story short, because I really don't want to go into that, I ended up quitting the site. So that was the end of my time at Channel Awesome. And the last Some Jerk with a Camera video I made was my Wizarding World of Harry Potter video in the fall of 2016. I didn't intend it to be my last at the time, but by then I had started doing other series like State of the Parks and One Movie Later, and those started taking up more and more of my time, and I just kept putting off getting back to Some Jerk, and eventually I started this podcast, and now that takes up most of my time, so you know, I might get back to Some Jerk someday and make a 4th season, never say never, but I honestly wouldn't count on it at this point. At least for now, this podcast is where I'm putting my creative juices for the time being.
Well, it's also better to be working on a podcast than a shot on location theme park review.
Especially right now.
Especially yeah. Right now.
I'm going to do an amazing review of the vaccination tents. My God.
Oh my God.
They don't fit theming at all.
Some Jerk with a Camera gets vaccinated.
Anyway, all 3 seasons of Some Jerk with a Camera are still available on my YouTube channel, warts and all, so please feel free to go back and binge them whenever you like. And that's the Some Jerk with a Camera story in a nutshell. So So, with all that out of the way, shall we talk about the Country Bears movie itself?
Oh, is that why we're here?
Yeah, apparently it is.
Yeah.
What is everyone's connection to the Country Bears movie?
I had no idea it existed before I saw your video. That was my introduction to the Country Bears movie, to the fact that Haunted Mansion and Pirates were not the first theme park films.
You don't even remember seeing ads for it or anything?
No, I don't. I don't think you understand how out of touch with general popular culture I was for a big chunk of my life. I grew up going to Disneyland, but I don't remember ever going to Country Bear Hall. Hmm. I don't think it was a thing that my family did when we were there.
Well, Country Bear Jamboree was kind of in a remote section of the park. Like, it stood where the Winnie the Pooh ride now stands.
And the two things that were there were Country Bear Hall and Splash Mountain.
Right.
And never went on Splash Mountain.
Well, there you go. You basically have no reason to go to Critter Country then.
Unless you're just really craving the Hungry Bear Inn.
The Hungry Bear.
Who craves that place? The food's so unremarkable.
Okay, legitimately, one time they had this funnel cake there that was a seasonal thing Haley and I just died for.
But also now there's a whole ass Galaxy's Edge in that direction, so now there's actually reason to walk over there.
The Critter Country entrance to Galaxy's Edge is objectively the best entrance, don't at me.
Like I said in my Splash Mountain video, once they re-theme Splash Mountain to Princess and the Frog, you will be able to trace the death of 2D animation. First Princess and the Frog, then Winnie the Pooh, then fuck it, let's buy Star Wars.
Yep.
I was familiar with the attraction Country Bear Jamboree, but I never experienced it as a kid. My sister and my mom did it while the rest of us were on Splash Mountain when my sister was too short. My only real experience with the franchise was the segment in the Disneyland Fun sing-along video.
Howdy, kids! Let's go play on Tom Sawyer's Island!
And then I finally saw it once in Florida, and I was like, yeah, that was cute. That was basically the extent of my experience with the attraction. The movie, I was aware of it when it came out. I remember seeing the TV spots with the cop's hair in the car wash a lot.
Right.
And I remember thinking, Country Bears?
Yeah.
Like, from the Jamboree? They're making a movie about that? And then, like I said, I saw the movie once when I checked it out from the library for a clip for the first Dave Does Disney. And watching it, the movie was funnier than I expected it to be. Which is not the highest bar, necessarily.
No, of course not.
They played the trailer for it when I saw Lilo and Stitch in theaters. I remember, like, having a similar reaction to Dave. Like, wait, this is for the show, right? The bear show. The one that I saw, like, once. This is a movie! I'm not going to see this because I'm 14. It's like, really? They're doing this? Literally the first time I saw it was when I was with you guys at a movie night.
I found like a VHS copy of it at Amoeba Records for $1. And I'm like, why the fuck not? And then I brought it to movie night and we watched the Country Bears on VHS just for a lark. And this was long after I'd made my review. That's how much it was seared into my brain.
And then, of course, after Disney Plus launched, that was like one of the first movies I sat down to watch.
Of course it was. Well, I too first saw the trailer of this movie in theaters with Lilo and Stitch, which I saw multiple times in theaters, so I saw this trailer multiple times.
Oh, God.
And I remember just, like you guys, being appalled that it even existed. That feeling of, this is a movie? They've sunk this low? What the fuck? This company that made Fantasia is now making this fucking stupid talking bear movie?
They're making movies based on theme park attractions? Jeez, what's next, pirates?
Exactly. And yeah, I never saw it in theaters, obviously, because who the fuck did? And when I finally made the decision to do that video about it, I don't know if you guys have ever experienced this, but I find that whenever I have to spend weeks on end painstakingly editing a video review of a really bad movie, I kind of start to develop a Stockholm syndrome for it, where I'm noticing all these little things that I didn't notice on the first watch. It's like, oh, that's what the director intended. Okay. And I start to have this begrudging admiration for it, even if I still don't like it. It happened with the Haunted Mansion movie. It happened with most of the ABC episodes I did. It didn't happen with Escape from Tomorrow. I still hate that piece of shit.
Good.
But it super happened with the Country Bears movie. I became low-key obsessed with this thing, and I remain so to this day. Like, I could just talk about this stupid movie for hours. That's why I brought the fucking VHS to movie night. And I've actually actually wanted to revisit it in something like this podcast for a long time now, because again, looking back, my original video was way too nostalgia critic-y, way too dismissive and snotty, and I've been itching to do a more straightforward analysis of it, or at least as straightforward as any analysis of the Country Bears could possibly be.
A post-mortem of it, a thesis.
Exactly, yeah.
Dissection, a treatise.
I mean, obviously one of the big questions surrounding this thing that we all had was, why even make it in the first place? Because if you look at the chronology, it does not make sense at all.
No.
The Country Bear Jamboree had been one of the opening day attractions at Walt Disney World in Florida in 1971, and it had been very popular there. And I've discussed this on other episodes of this podcast, but when its clone opened in Disneyland in 1972, they built a whole land around it called Bear Country, and they added a second theater, and they built their biggest bathroom facility in the park at the time right next to it. But it never attracted the crowds they thought it would in California. It was off in this remote area of the park where almost no one went, there was never a line for it, and as I mentioned in the video, the Disneyland version closed down 10 months before the movie came out.
Yep.
Disneyland's Country Bear Jamboree closed in September 2001. The movie opened in July 2002.
And that's legitimately what I thought the whole plotline revolved around, was saving the attraction.
I mean, it may as well have been. Disney was shutting down the attraction while also dumping money into this movie, which, as I point out in the video, is about trying to save Country Bear Hall from being torn down. And even if you ignore all that, it's just objectively such a weird choice for a movie. Even if you like Country Bear Jamboree, was anyone who saw it really clamoring for it to be subjected to a three-act structure? The closest thing I have to a working theory of why did they think this was a good idea is, first of all, at the tail end of 2000, a little album came out called the Oh Brother, Where Art Thou soundtrack.
Oh.
And I'm sure right now some of my younger listeners are thinking, what, that Coen Brothers movie with George Clooney? Yeah. It's easy to forget, especially if you weren't there, but the soundtrack album to that movie was a monster hit, completely unexpectedly.
I am a man of constant sorrow. I've seen trouble all my day.
Fantastic.
Alison Krauss and Union Station were everywhere.
It was inescapable. Maybe that led the Disney execs to think, wow, country's really coming back in a big way. Although even then, the fact that this newfound love for country apparently didn't translate to the Country Bear Jamboree getting enough renewed interest to keep it alive.
No.
Maybe that should have been a red flag.
And then Country Bear Jamboree ended up getting replaced by Oh Bother, Where Art Thou?
Ah! The other part of the theory I have is that at the time, Disney still had yet to acquire the Muppets. And I think Eisner was always a little bitter that he'd failed to do so in the early 90s. I think he saw the Country Bears as Disney's attempt to make their own Muppets. Because the bear suits in the movie were created by the Jim Henson Creature Shop.
Do you think they might have known that he wanted to make them like the Muppets and were doing some Machiavellian sabotage behind the scenes?
I mean, like I said in the video, the movie is basically Blues Brothers meets the Muppet Movie meets Grizzly Man. Bizarrely enough, the plot of this movie ended up being nearly identical to the 2011 Muppets movie, which came out less than a year after my review. I mean, stop me if you've heard this one. There's this hardcore fan of this group of Jim Henson creatures who haven't performed together in a while. By the way, the name of the group is also the title of the movie. Oh, and did I mention that the fan is also a Jim Henson creation and clearly belongs to the same species as the group, despite being raised by a human family, and the movie ends with the fan being accepted into the group? Anyway, the fan finds out that the old concert venue the group used to perform at is about to be destroyed, so the fan team up with the group's old MC, and they go on a quest to get the group back together to put on a benefit concert to raise the money to save the venue, which incidentally is being threatened by an evil rich guy with a personal vendetta against the group, played by an elderly Oscar-winning character actor named Chris. It's the same damn movie, except Muppets 2011 did it better.
The Country Bears was directed by Peter Hastings, who created Pinky and the Brain, Kane, and I think Paul Rugg did some punch-up writing on it.
He did indeed. Paul Rugg did an uncredited rewrite. Paul Rugg, of course, also an Animaniacs writer, probably best known as the voice of Freakazoid, and now he's got his own show on Disney Plus called Earth to Ned, also a Jim Henson production. And he's got a cameo in this movie as a news anchor.
This man is involved in the abduction of this 10-year-old boy. Police also believe his accomplices are this man, and this chicken, who are all traveling in this bus.
And maybe this is just me being biased because I'm a huge Animaniacs fan, but it really does feel like all the good things in this movie were Hastings and Rugg's contributions. Like, I have to imagine they were the ones who pushed for Christopher Walken, just because they had caricatured him so many times on Animaniacs and Pinky and the Brain that they must have relished the opportunity to work with the real thing.
Sometimes when I'm riding my bike around dusk, then I see the two rotating reflectors of another bike coming towards me. I have this sudden impulse to swerve into this oncoming bike.
And by the way, when this movie was about to come out, Paul Rugg was commissioned to write a sequel, which would have taken the Bears on a tour of Europe, which is another weird parallel between this and the 2010s Muppet movies.
Yes.
God.
But of course, this movie flopped and the sequel was never made.
So there was a lot of legitimate comedic talent working on the movie, but they were also very clearly being held back by what the movie had to be, which was a late-stage Eisnerian desperate attempt at a franchise without actually laying the groundwork for that franchise.
The movie as a whole is really awkward. It keeps going back and forth between this straightforward, boring, earnest, unintentionally stupid kids movie and this weird, absurdist, very intentionally stupid live-action cartoon.
From my memory, my biggest impression of this movie as a whole is that it is the inverse of the Haunted Mansion movie. The Haunted Mansion movie has a couple of good moments that are based on directly translating the source material, and then where it gets bogged down is Eddie Murphy trying to be funny.
Right.
This movie has a few good moments that are the writers and the director actually being funny, and where it gets bogged down is having to be tied to the source material.
And the challenge of working with those bear suits could not have possibly helped. I mean, the puppeteering was actually a bit of a point of contention for a while. Peter Hastings' background, of course, was in animation, so he just thought, well, we'll record the voice actors first and then have the puppeteers lip sync. And it was the Jim Henson people who told him, that's not how this works. We've got to operate these puppets in real time. Lip sync never works in puppetry unless you're doing a musical number. You have to let us actually perform these characters live on set or it's just not going to work. They did a few screen tests which confirmed, yeah, puppets lip syncing really doesn't work. So the puppeteers did play the bears live on set, and then the actors they hired to do the voices dubbed their voices later.
I know at a certain point that's what Frank Oz was doing on Muppets projects. He was
just
ADRing Piggy's and Fozzie's lines before Eric Jacobson replaced him wholesale.
Same with him as Yoda on the Star Wars prequels.
Yeah, because he had his own directing career by that point, and he was way too busy directing Bowfinger to actually be on set for Muppets from Space.
Jerry Nelson also did a lot of Muppet ADR towards the end of his life when he could no longer physically lift his puppets.
The Country Bears, obviously, is available to watch on Disney Plus, but if you really want the full Country Bears movie experience, and why in God's holy name wouldn't you? You have to track down the original DVD. I'm not kidding. Every last special feature on the DVD operates under the premise that the movie is a biopic based on a true story. Like it's Spinal Tap or Buckaroo Banzai or something.
The Country Bears movie attempted to faithfully recreate the events that led to the reunion of the band, going so far as to cast Tennessee, Fred, Ted, and Zeb to play themselves.
I think it was important to use the real bears because, I mean, you wouldn't want to get actors to play, you know, the Beatles in A Hard Day's Night.
They make up this mythology that the Bears were this real, huge musical act from the 70s, and they inspired the Disneyland attraction.
Oh my God.
So in-universe, the Country Bear Jamboree attraction was the original Rock and Roller Coaster.
Yep, it sure was.
Oh my God.
Or Captain EO.
Yeah.
Why?
And the commentary track on this movie is the director, Peter Hastings, alongside Diedrich Bader and Stephen Root, in character as two of the bears.
I don't know if you guys are familiar with Christopher Walken. I don't know if you...
He was a nice guy. I hung out with him.
Did you?
Uh-huh. I had some time.
I tried to meet him once, but he looked at me and I got frightened.
Well, it's, you know, you get beyond that. He's a real sweetheart.
Well, that's good.
It's fucking nuts. You gotta track down the DVD if you can.
I am gratified to know that that is a thing that happened. This might come from them being experienced experienced comedy writers and realizing the only way out is through. Yes. We are going to commit to this bit. We are going to jettison all self-awareness. The only way we're ever going to get any sort of creative fulfillment out of this is if we just hit the bottom and keep digging. We are going to the center of the earth on this thing.
And the fucked up thing is, even while they're doing this narrative, even while they're committing to this bit, they still can't 100% commit because they'll cut to behind-the-scenes B-roll footage showing one of the bears talking to the director, and in the background you'll see another bear just drooped over a chair motionless.
Oh, man.
Still see the string, Stromboli.
Oh, shit, one of the actors died. Please enjoy this beautiful music, folks, and we will be right back on the Some Jerk with a Camera 10th Anniversary Spectacular episode of Escape from Walt Disney with our thoughts on the 2002 cinematic masterwork, The Country Bears.
Come on home. See what's waiting for you.
Okay, we just watched The Country Bears right here on Escape from Walt Disney, and that was a trip down memory lane, wasn't it?
That was.
You know, it's not good. I acknowledge that it's objectively not good, but it has that weird energy that some bad movies have, where the people involved kind of realize from the outset, okay, realistically, there's no way this is going to be good, so fuck it. Let's just make our kind of bad movie.
With all the different movie homages and the weird whiplash between Keystone Cops and the heartwarming, almost famous homages,
right,
and the fully produced music videos with these tween pop stars.
Yeah, they did not have a consistent vision for this damn thing. They're just kind of throwing shit at the wall and seeing what works.
And you'd put on top of all of that those frankly unsettling bear suits.
Yeah.
Theoretically, I mean, suspension of disbelief works for a lot. If the story had been super engaging, I think people could overlook the bear suits.
And if a frog had wings, it wouldn't bump its ass when it hops.
Right, exactly.
That's also like asking people not to stare into the eyes of Mara. Yeah. They're gonna do it.
Those big clunky bear suits could not have been easy to work with under the best of circumstances.
Yeah.
No.
Just given the usual demands of filmmaking, and also the fact that the director had never worked with puppets before. In the video, I give a lot of shit to the shot where the shed falls down in the background and Big Al's in the foreground and his eyes widen like a full second before his head jerks back. I don't know how many takes they got, but that was clearly the best one. So you kind of have to feel for these people.
Yeah.
The eyes and the mouth are never moving at quite the same speed.
Nope.
You're constantly getting an eyeful of their shockingly realistic, for some reason, giant bear teeth.
Yep.
Whose idea was that? That was a terrible idea.
Fucking sharp teeth and the tiny dead eyes also.
Yeah.
The bears in Country Bear Jamboree were all cute and cuddly, and these are the opposite.
Which is extra wild because it's not even like you're doing a live-action remake. You are literally translating something that already exists in a physical 3D animatronic,
yep,
space. If they wanted to make them look like the characters in the show, they could easily have done that.
I don't know. I guess maybe they thought they looked too cute.
There's one bear in the show that consistently bares his teeth. Pun intended. There's always a point where he's looking at the audience and lifting his upper lip, showing off his teeth. And I'm wondering if somebody in the Henson shop was like, hey.
I have to think that this is a case where they didn't screen test the puppets before they arrived.
No way.
They were stuck with them.
The first day of principal photography. And they see what they have, and they see what they look like on camera.
Oh god, we're doomed.
These were the Sonic the Hedgehog of their day.
I mentioned Spinal Tap briefly in the intro, and in the opening song of this movie,
yep,
they turn the knob up to 12.
Yep.
Which, number one, that's writing a check that this movie can't cash.
For what it's worth, that 12 was painted onto the amp with whiteout,
yeah,
which is kind of a metaphor for this movie.
Pretty much.
Let's just pretend.
But also, it's yet another time that the crank it up to 11 joke has been completely misinterpreted, because the whole point of that joke in the original Spinal Tap was that it's fucking pointless.
Yep.
Like, it doesn't actually make it go any louder. You're just moving the goalposts like an idiot. So here, they're just moving the goalposts even further like idiots.
Yep.
Which
yep.
could be acceptable, like, even the Bears missed the point of it, were it not for the fact that the universe paints the Bears as a legitimately influential band.
Yeah.
Influencing musicians across genres.
Right, like Exhibit.
They're like ursine Dewey Coxes. Or even more ursine than John C. Reilly is.
But that does beg the question, would this have been better if it were a Spinal Tap homage more than a Blues Brothers homage?
Probably, but Disney wasn't going to finance that. They needed big, heartwarming movie.
Ugh.
But yeah, the plot of this was basically just the Blues Brothers with bears. The Bears Brothers.
It's Blues Brothers combined with Almost Famous, combined with Dukes of Hazzard.
You know what it's not combined with very much? The actual Country Bear Jamboree.
No! There's very few references to the Country Bear Jamboree. It's basically just the names of the bears. Henry, Big Al, and Trixie are all characters, and the names of the band members all come from the song Bear Band Serenade.
The Bear Bear Bands will play now in the good old key of G. Zeke and Zeb, Ted and Fred, and a bear named Tennessee.
And even then, they don't even include Zeke. They have the word Zeke on the bus, and if I remember correctly, there was a moment on the commentary, which, like I said, was in-universe, where they heavily imply that Zeke died.
Oh.
Like, he was in the band way back when, but something happened to him, and they named the bus after him in his honor.
Things got dark.
You'd think that if they could wrench some melodrama from this movie, they would have had that in the story. They would have actually talked about that.
Maybe.
Plus, it would have established that the band has an opening.
But instead, it's just one of a handful of weird Easter eggs.
Teddy Bear is on the boat.
The boat is the Teddy Barracuda. They mention Liver Lips McGrawl
and Gomer.
I tell you, a lot of great music was on that stage. There's Flattin' Scruggs, Liver Lips McGraw, Gomer. Jimi Hendrix opened here for Vanilla Fudge.
And over radio chatter from the police car, you hear Wendell mentioned.
Oh, okay.
Oh.
An officer mentions Wendell got his head stuck in the fence again.
I knew that had to be some sort of in-joke.
Also, I found out while they were shooting the movie, one day Peter Hastings said, you know what? There aren't enough references to Country Bear Jamboree in this movie. Fuck it. Let's shoot a scene where Big Al sings Blood on the Saddle.
There was blood on the saddle and blood all around.
We'll throw it in during the end credits or something as a treat to the fans. And they shot it, but they ended up not putting it anywhere in the movie just because it had nothing to do with anything. But, you know, Peter Hastings was trying, man. And unfortunately, the DVD doesn't have any deleted scenes, so it's nowhere to be seen.
The world building is very vague on how bears fit into this universe. They can't fit into cars, but we do see a scratching post for bears in one of the bars.
Right.
Yeah, very Magic Fingers gag.
We see a payphone made specially for bears with an extra long mouthpiece.
Well, it's just the extension. It's called Telecub, and it's a thing you extend to payphones to make them accessible to bears. It's not like the full payphone is shaped like that.
Oh, gotcha.
Because I noticed in one shot, after the phone call was over, Henry disconnected it and put it on top of the thing.
But they invent devices to make right. these things accommodating for bears.
Which, by the way, I feel like that payphone thing was probably a last-minute addition when they noticed on set, oh shit, the phone doesn't reach his mouth.
Who's got a shoehorn?
But at the same time, their bus labels that they're on the Hibernation Tour.
Yep.
So on some level, they're marketing themselves off of the fact that they're bears, despite the fact that bears ostensibly coexist in this universe. So are the Country Bears a minstrel act?
Oh my. They were even performing for an audience exclusively of humans.
Well, that brings up an interesting point, because the band members are not the only bears in people clothes in this movie. Every so often we see a bear extra in the background working at the car wash or drinking honey at the bar.
Never more than one per scene.
It's probably just the same extra bear that they had lying around.
Yeah.
So it seems like, okay, bears are just treated like people in this universe. But at the same time, the brother shows Barry the tracking collar.
Right.
And says, the Rangers use this to track you. So is this like the bear equivalent of segregation? Like in some states, bears are free to live fulfilling lives and pursue careers in platinum-selling rock bands. But in other states, they're just treated like animals? Is a bear legally considered 3/5 of a person?
It's treated like a joke that only the brother seems to realize that Barry the Berry Bear Bear is a bear. And not a human.
But the thing is, because bears are intelligent in this movie, and because bears can clearly think for themselves and function as people, basically, the brother's a fucking racist.
Yeah.
In context, that's the only way to read his character. He's got thick brown hair all over his body. There's even one joke that got cut from the movie, but it's in the trailer. It's right after Barry's run away from home, and the mom is just crying her eyes out, and the brother says, "Well, you knew you'd have to release him into the wild eventually."
Ooh.
Oh my god.
So this kid is a fucking alt-right piece of shit. He definitely grew up to storm the Capitol. I think we can all agree on that.
Oh yeah.
He was the guy in the Viking helmet who only eats organic food, only he was wearing fake barriers and growling at people.
I'm the real Big Al.
This is the problem you sometimes run into when you have a straight man character in a world built on absurdity.
Right.
For the purpose of a comedy sketch, you can have that straight man character who's like, this is insane. This parody is no more. But when you're actually trying to build a world that a narrative hangs in, where this is what is normal in this world,
exactly,
to have that straight man audience avatar character,
it'd be like if someone in the Muppet movie was just going, they're all made of felt, man, what's wrong with you, they're all socks.
I think that first scene with the cops would have been funnier without the brother going like, hey, isn't this crazy?
Yeah.
I think it would have been funnier if they just played it deadpan. Does he have any identifying markings? Well, he has brown hair.
Yeah.
And like they kept dancing around it. And then they hand the picture to them and they end with that, oh, he looks like a fourth grader?
Yeah, right.
If that was the punchline, it would have worked perfectly.
I feel like the brother's contributions might have been a studio note. Like, you gotta have someone acknowledge how weird it is.
Yeah. Most likely.
I think they might have been looking for a source of tension between Barry and his brother.
Possibly.
And this was what they landed on for some reason.
Speaking of racism, the bears are racist against pandas.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was a dark joke.
Took off with some rich millionaire real estate guy. A panda.
Ugh, what's with the pandas? They get everything.
If we cut to them now, they'd be calling COVID the panda virus.
Oh, God.
There is always a temptation when you're creating a world like this, I suppose, to use sort of fantasy racism to flavor it. That is a loaded gun to be playing with.
Well, they're not even making it overt that it's a racism allegory. The brother is never called out for his racism, and the panda joke is the closest this movie ever gets to being bear bright.
In this version of the universe, the Second Amendment is absolutely the right to arm bears.
No question. I mean, this is the downside of having a who fucking cares attitude towards making a movie like this, is you get all this dumb inconsistency that does not hold up to scrutiny at all. I mean, the upside of it is you get some of the funnier shit in this movie.
They don't develop the straight concepts enough, and there's not enough chaotic energy in this world to combat that.
Yeah, it's kind of stuck in the space between spaces in that regard. Like, it's not cartoony enough to be a live-action cartoon,
right,
but it's also way too fucking bonkers to be anything resembling reality.
So any of those super emotional scenes that just come basically out of nowhere,
yep,
you feel nothing. Like, it feels awkward.
I want to talk about the scene where Tennessee, the bear voiced by Toby Huss, is revealed to be a marriage counselor. It feels like it's a reboot of something that never existed. Like, this bear's principal character trait is that he's over-emotional, and he breaks into tears at the slightest provocation, so naturally, the funny thing is to make him a marriage counselor. It's like, again, in Muppets 2011, when we find out Animal is in anger management rehab.
In control.
Except in this movie, we have never met this character before, in
yeah,
any medium. Even in Country Bear Jamboree, Fred was the one who played the mouth harp, quote, kind of sad.
Big Fred's playing mouth harp. He plays it kind of sad. He never took a lesson. He just picked it up from Dad.
Which they do reference in this movie when Fred yeah, said, my dad got me this harmonica. Making Tennessee a marriage counselor is like a parody when we've never seen the original.
He's over-emotional. He just cannot function without his girlfriend.
Mm-hmm.
And then for the rest of the movie, she's like on his arm and he's still hyper-emotional.
Gee, I wonder why they broke up.
I wonder why they broke up. I wonder why she left you, dude.
And she doesn't have any personality whatsoever.
Zero personality. She doesn't bring much to the band. Like, we see her as this Bonnie Raitt Raitt, not superstar, but you know.
Well, literally, her singing voice is Bonnie Raitt.
She's singing in some motel somewhere, so she's not a superstar, but that's the last time she ever gets the spotlight.
And it's not even her song, it becomes a duet with her and the other bear.
She has maybe two lines in group scenes later.
And she, like, goes back to him right immediately.
Yep.
It's such a temporary obstacle.
Their singing voices are Don Henley and Bonnie Raitt. And it cuts to the actual Don Henley and Bonnie Raitt sitting at the bar, which is kind of a neat joke. And Bonnie Raitt says, man, the Country Bears were a great band. And Don Henley says, better than the Eagles, which I feel like might have been an improv.
Probably.
Most likely.
Like, that was Don Henley both continuing his lifelong streak as a raging asshole and getting revenge on Glenn Frey for being an equally raging asshole.
Speaking of actors who do voices and make on-camera appearances in this, obviously the big one is Diedrich Bader.
Right, Diedrich Bader both plays one of the cops and does the voice of one of the bears.
The most prominent dual role. I believe John Hyatt also does the singing voice.
John Hyatt, who wrote most of the songs in this movie, does the singing voice of the Diedrich Bader bear.
And he shows up in the end credits documentary footage.
Right.
Weirdly enough, an actor who only shows up on camera is Jess Harnell.
I believe he does some of the voices in the bear cartoon that they watch in the motel room.
Okay, that makes sense.
Yeah. That sounded like Jess Harnell to me.
So long, country bear!
Whoa, what the? Look, he's shooting a ray gun at us! Come on, let's run! Fred, your harmonica might disrupt the alien's brainwaves. Blow, blow, Fred, blow!
When I was making my original video, I tried to think of a joke about that cartoon because it just seemed too weird not to comment on. I just couldn't think of a way to make it more ridiculous than it already was.
It's a gag I love, though.
It is, yeah.
I'm a sucker for Hanna-Barbera parodies and Filmation parodies.
The Country Hair Bear Bunch.
And it predates that Incredibles DVD bonus feature with the Clutch Cargo-style Mr. Incredible cartoon.
The adventures of Mr. Incredible with his pals Frozone and Mr. Skipperdoo.
Speaking of cartoony interpretations of the bears, after the bus goes through the car wash, it's revealed that the artwork on the side of the bus depicts the bears getting magic powers from a wizard's lightning bolts. It's like that art that gets painted on the side of panel vans.
That felt a little too 80s for a band that would have been big in the 70s.
Well, the band broke up in 91, so that was probably just the most recent iteration of the bus art.
That car wash sequence had to have been somebody's baby. Someone was determined, you know what, goddammit, if this is the only funny part of the movie.
I don't know, that's not my favorite scene in the movie, because personally, I don't think the cops have that much chemistry. Like, they're both good actors, Diedrich Bader and Daryl Chill Mitchell, but they don't play off each other that well, to my taste.
They do feel kind of awkward around each other. I'm not sure if that's supposed to be part of the gag, that, like, they're new partners who are rough around the edges, because they even ask each other questions as if they don't really know much about each other.
Right.
Like, Chill Mitchell doesn't even know that Diedrich Bader's mustache is fake until it comes off.
Well, that to me would have been even funnier if they'd known each other for years.
That could be true.
You've been my partner for 12 years and I'm just finding out your mustache is fake. The cops had a few good lines here and there. I particularly like Chill Mitchell's line.
Listen to me, son. You can be sure that they're going to be keeping him in some creepy underground lair high up in the building until they get their ransom, okay?
The money they spent punching up that script was not wasted.
Right.
Well, it was wasted because it was for the Country Bears, but someone talented got paid for that.
And the car wash scene, if it works at all, and I think that's debatable, it works just because of the escalation of it. Just because they go so far to the point where they're actually fucking flying on the hot air blast.
Yep.
I mean, if you're the cops and you're chasing someone who just went into a car wash, why not just wait for them by the exit?
Because shenaniganism.
It has the perfect payoff at the end credits.
Right.
The post-credits out.
The fucking Marvel post-credit scene.
If they had just stopped the cop storyline right there.
Bring that scene back to the main body of the movie and just have the fucking water pouring out of the car forever.
Yeah, and have that be the last we see of the cops.
Exactly.
Send them off on a high note.
Because when they're back in the house, that never pays off.
Yeah, what happens to them?
There must have been a deleted scene where something happened to them, because otherwise they would have been there taking credit for Barry showing up.
I'm pretty sure they only kept that one scene in the movie because the underground lair high in a building gag probably got a laugh in test screenings.
Yeah.
We gotta keep every laugh.
The bears aren't giving us anything.
We got so few of them. Come on, let us have this.
Before the chase begins, they do a suspicious activity at 2 o'clock and Diedrich Bader looks at his watch, which is a very old joke.
Right.
Then they do a callback to it, sort of, where Diedrich Bader sees the bus going into the car wash. Next to it is a sign that says, bingo at 9 p.m.
Right.
And Diedrich Bader says, bingo, 9 o'clock.
Yep.
I feel like that joke would have worked a lot better if we saw Diedrich Bader say that before we saw the sign.
Yeah, it was literally the reverse of a joke from Naked Gun, where Leslie Nielsen's looking through drawers and goes, bingo, and then he just pulls out a bingo card.
Bingo, 9 o'clock. And oh look, there's the bus too.
I will bet you anything, they wrote the joke with the intention of doing it that way, like he says it and then you see the sign, but the timing didn't work out in editing, so they just flipped the shots.
Probably.
There are so many sign-related gags in this movie. Why so many signs?
It's a sign!
My favorite joke in this movie, and part of the reason it's my favorite joke is because I wrote a very similar joke in a script that I never did anything with when I was young.
Mm-hmm.
So I was so excited to see this joke actually get used in something. And that is the gag where it looks like Alex Rocco is in his office.
Yes.
And then it
yes.
pulls out and he's just in like an Office Depot.
Yeah, I love that fucking joke.
It's a perfect joke. I wrote a very similar joke where it's like getting something out of the fridge in the kitchen and it pulls out and you're just in the Home Depot kitchen display for a project that I abandoned years before this movie came out. So I was so glad to see that joke executed basically the way I envisioned it when I wrote it into a dumb script when I was a kid. The movie gets like 500 extra points from me just for that gag alone.
Absolutely. And yeah, that's another thing I neglected to mention in my video. Alex Rocco is in this movie.
Playing possibly a relative of his character from That Thing You Do, who knows?
He's in like two scenes and then he had to go because his planet needed him. I will say though, one area where I thought the world building really did work for me, maybe this is just because I grew up with a dad who had a massively extensive record collection. Like, Charlie Morgan, you've both seen my dad's yes. record collection.
Yes. Can verify that Tony's dad is the music guy.
And by the way, if there's any vinyl record collectors or aspiring vinyl record collectors out there listening, my dad runs a website called vinylbeat.com with a bunch of price guides and such. Go check that out. So anyway, being the son of a massive record collector, I grew up just surrounded by vinyl records and music memorabilia, including a lot of country stuff, because my dad's a big old-school country fan. The production design of all the music memorabilia of the history of the Country Bears, both on Barry's wall at his home and scattered throughout the Country Bear tour bus, all that shit is great. Like, if you freeze frame and just look at the little details of it, I love the effort they put into making all that shit feel tactile and real. Although, the scene where the poster comes alive and talks to Barry, that was something
yeah, no.
that required eye bleach. That's fucking terrifying. It's possible that one of the reasons I've become so unnaturally obsessed with this stupid fucking movie is that in a lot of ways, I do relate to Barry Barrington's obsession with the Country Bears, because as a teenager, and even stretching well into adulthood, I had a very, very similar obsession with Weird Al.
Of course.
And there are so many parallels. Like, I would also watch Al's Behind the Music special on VHS over and over again.
I've never slept with a band member. I've never crippled a band member. I've never stayed in my boat for 3 days on a heroin binge. I've never had to deal with weight problems. I've never slept with so many women I lost count. I've never lip-synced to my songs except in music videos. And I never was an alcoholic. I never was a poster child for marijuana smoking. And I've never married my 13-year-old cousin. So what do you want from me?
I had Weird Al posters all over my walls. I still do, in fact. I, too, would constantly interrupt normal conversations to randomly interject Weird Al trivia that no one else gave a shit about.
Did you know the Bears made the only country song ever to be recorded in Polish?
Every school project I did would be about Al somehow, to the point where my teachers would openly wonder if something was wrong with me. So I can see how, at least on the page, Barry's character captured something very real about adolescent fandom. Unfortunately, in the movie, is it me or is Haley Joel Osment's voice performance just astonishingly terrible? Like, anyone who's seen The Sixth Sense or AI knows that he was one of the best child actors of his generation, bar none.
Fuck, even in Secondhand Lions.
He even got an Oscar nomination for The Sixth Sense at age 11, very well deserved.
He carries The Sixth Sense. That movie is nothing if it's not his performance.
Absolutely, but he's just completely phoning it in this one.
Wait a minute. Wait a minute. I got it!
This was around the same time that he had voiced the lead character of the first Kingdom Hearts game.
Sora.
Oh, really? Okay.
And that performance was pretty flat, too.
It was also around the time he voiced Mowgli in The Jungle Book 2, speaking of bears.
Oh, my God.
Maybe in this case it was just the challenge of dubbing his voice to an already existent performance that the puppeteers had done.
I have to imagine that was part of it, because in a movie that has the actual Christopher Walken, Haley Joel Osment gives the most Walken-y performance.
Tear down Country Bear Hall?
Tear down Country Bear Hall?
Is it time?
Fuck it, let's talk about Walken.
It's time.
Talking about Walken, motherfucker.
These boots are made for Walken.
I'm not telling anyone anything they don't already know. But Christopher Walken is fucking amazing in this.
He's so good.
Because he commits, goddammit. He was doing exactly the opposite of Haley Joel Osment phoning it in. He is in full King of New York mode in this fucking movie, just bringing every last ounce of gravitas to this stupid bear movie.
That role in the hands of any other actor,
it just wouldn't have had the magic.
No.
Famously, this movie is part of the reason Walken is one of the few actors to get a Razzie nomination and an Oscar nomination in the same year.
He got a Razzie nomination for this. So undeserved.
Oh, yeah.
Fortunately, lost out to Hayden Christensen in Attack of the Clones.
Well, that's good.
And yeah, it was the same year Walken was nominated for an Oscar for Catch Me If You Can and lost out to Chris Cooper in Adaptation, who oddly enough went on to play the villain in Muppets 2011, playing basically the same role Walken plays here.
That whole scene where it's just him smashing model after model after model of Country Bear Hall, shooting that must have been the most fun they had on set. Just because he chews every little bit of scenery.
Well, I have to imagine every scene in this movie that did not involve the bear suits was a reason to celebrate.
Yes.
But it's hard to describe just how transcendent the oh no Country Bear Hall has been crushed scene really is. It's Christopher Walken in boxer shorts and bunny slippers.
Yes.
Which we don't see at first. The reveal of that was great.
Demolishing model after model of Country Bear Hall with an anvil and screaming, oh no! Country Bear Hall has been crushed.
With a video of things being destroyed in the background.
Video of buildings blowing up and the Tacoma Narrows Bridge shaking.
Yep.
And on the soundtrack, you hear Everything Is Broken by Bob Dylan. Like, this scene is the reason movies were invented.
Yes.
We may as well pack it in and stop making movies now. We've done it. We're never going to top that shit.
We've peaked.
Imagine having to take your damn wiener kids to see this movie and you're bored out of your skull, but then suddenly that happens. Like, holy shit, your mind is just blown.
And your kids are weirded out by how loudly you're suddenly freaking out.
Oh, no! Country Bear Hall has been crushed!
And while we're on the subject of Christopher Walken, we have to talk about
the line.
The dichotomy between that day is tonight and this is not over bears. Now, for those who don't know, at the end of this movie, after the bears finally defeat Christopher Walken, his last line is, this is not over! Bears!
This is not over! Bears!
Now, when the Nostalgia Critic made his Christopher Walken video, he singled out that line and made, I thought, the best possible joke you could make about that moment, which is that it sounds like Christopher Walken just noticed there were bears in the movie. This is not over! Bears! So when I did my review, I thought, well, Doug already did that joke, so I won't even bother. I didn't even mention this is not over bears. I did a similar joke about another Christopher Walkenism that I liked even more, which is that day is tonight.
Since that day, I'm plotting my revenge, waiting for the day to destroy the place that brought me misery. Well, that day is tonight.
Which is better.
It's fucking brilliant.
Objectively, that one is better.
But here's the thing. By far, over the last 10 years, the question I have received the most about that video is, why didn't you mention this is not over bears? Because Doug Walker already did! I didn't want to overtly ride his coattails! At least not till the Sorcerer's Apprentice video. Also, one thing that I had never noticed before about this movie, but I noticed it watching this time, at the beginning of the That Day Is Tonight scene, Christopher Walken is wearing a bandolier full of tranquilizer darts. That is goddamn brilliant. I also love that Walken's rationale for wanting revenge on the bears is that they ruined his life by beating him in that talent contest and forced him to become a rich, successful bank owner instead of a professional armpit farter.
Oh, the poor millionaire.
I could have opened for Jeff Foxworthy, damn it. Instead, I've got all these millions of dollars.
Poor you.
I do love that his character is so obsessed with this singular vision of destroying Country Bear Hall that his hood ornament is a wrecking ball.
His hood ornament is a wrecking ball. That's fucking genius.
Reading the room, I only have maybe something of a slightly controversial hot take on Christopher Walken. I love him to death. That's not the take. He's just such a non-entity in this movie.
Oh, I completely disagree.
He's the only real presence.
I mean, in terms of screen time,
here's what I mean by that, though. After the scenes he's in are done, you forget he's in the movie. Until he comes back, and it's such a shocking surprise.
Honestly, that just makes it more effective.
Yeah, exactly.
He's like a ninja, just strikes when you least expect him. And incidentally, he got top billing in this movie. I actually counted. I measured each of his scenes. Christopher Walken has roughly 7.5 minutes of screen time in this 88-minute movie, and he got top billing for it, and you know what? He fucking deserved it. Because he is the reason to see this shit.
So, a quote that for decades I have seen attributed to Christopher Walken, I've never found what interview he said this in, but I presume this was his answer to the question, why did you do the Country Bears? Bear costumes are funny. Bears as well.
Yep.
Checks out.
That's walking all right.
All right, Uncle Chris.
One aspect of this movie that I really gave short shrift in my video that I really want to praise at this point are the songs.
Yes.
Yeah.
We mentioned John Hyatt, who wrote all but one of the original songs in this movie and also did the singing voice of Ted Betterhead. Now, if anyone out there is not familiar with John Hyatt's music, please start listening to it. He is a world-class, tremendously talented, criminally underrated singer-songwriter. He's been active for almost 50 years now. He's dabbled in multiple genres, which I'm sure is why they got him in this film. Never achieved that much chart success, unfortunately. Probably his best-known song was the 1987 adult contemporary ballad, Have a Little Faith in Me.
Have a little faith in me.
At the risk of being cliche, he's a real musician's musician. Like, on his own, he's not nearly as famous as he deserves to be, but some of the biggest music stars of the last few decades have counted him as a major influence. Like, this movie was not the first time Don Henley or Bonnie Raitt performed a song he wrote. In fact, he even wrote one of Bonnie Raitt's biggest hits, Thing Called Love.
Are you ready for the thing called love? Don't come for me and you would go somewhere for both.
But I highly recommend his entire catalog. It's just brilliant, brilliant stuff. And he brings it to the songs he wrote for this movie.
I'm legitimately shocked to learn that those songs were original.
Oh, yeah.
Especially like the song about going on up the road, which Barry sings and which comes back in the end credits. I'm like, wow, I'm jiving to this.
Yeah, that was written by John Hyatt specifically for this movie. And fun fact, by the way, Barry's singing voice is E.G. Daly, who's best known for voicing Buttercup on the Powerpuff Girls and Tommy in Rugrats.
Nice.
Oh.
There's a town down the road where I ain't been before. Nobody knows my name or what I'm looking for.
And they also got some insanely top-tier musicians to play on these songs. Just to name a few of the players on this soundtrack, they got Mike Campbell and Benmont Tench of Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers, Davey Farragher and Pete Thomas of Elvis Costello and the Impostors.
Wow.
Legendary blues guitarist Sonny Landreth played the guitar solo on Let It Ride, the opening song. And just singing background vocals on Straight to the Heart of Love, the big climactic song, I'm not kidding, Colin Hay, the lead singer of Men at Work.
Wow.
Oh my God.
Just nuts, the talent they got on this thing.
That's what he was doing when he wasn't just hanging around the set of Scrubs.
Whoever wrangled that lineup together was on something next level while they were making this.
Well, I think mostly they just really wanted to work with John Hyatt. Like I said, the man is beloved.
I imagine some of it was Peter Hastings and everyone else involved being like, okay, if we're saddled with having to make this movie that has to have these broad jokes, we're stuck with these big bulky costumes, we're stuck with all these things weighing us down, the one thing they can't limit us on is the soundtrack.
Well, to a point, because you do still have to have the teen pop songs and all that shit.
There is that awkward Crystal Marie Harris music video in the middle.
One of the special features on the DVD is a music video for the Crystal Harris song, and it's the music video that they're filming in-universe in the movie.
I figured as much.
But without any bears in it. So they simultaneously put so much thought into this shit and no thought at all, because on the one hand, that's kind of clever. Hey, while we've got this fake music video set, let's just shoot the video, and that'll be the movie's official tie-in video. But on the other hand, you got a tie-in video for the Country Bears without any Country Bears.
I have to think that everyone who saw what those bears actually looked like on camera was like, can we possibly take the bears out of the promotion?
Record label's like, fuck this shit.
Can we do one take without the bears?
The two teen pop stars with the big musical cameos in this were Crystal Marie Harris and Jennifer Page, who I'm sure are both very nice people, but you can tell they were both the producers' like eighth or ninth choices. Because let's face it, if you're a teen pop star with a strong, blossoming career, why in God's name would you say yes to this? They're clearly trying to invoke the Blues Brothers, where they're just trying to get to the next plot point, and all of a sudden, here's Ray Charles or Aretha Franklin launching into a musical number, but it's not Ray Charles or Aretha Franklin, it's Crystal Marie Harris and Jennifer Page.
Yeah.
I did some research. You could make the argument that this movie killed both their careers, because up to this point, Crystal Harris had opened for the Backstreet Boys, and she'd performed the big lead single for the Princess Diaries the previous year.
Yeah.
And Jennifer Page had been a one-hit wonder whose only hit was the song Crush in 1998. Remember that?
No.
It's just a little crush.
Oh my God.
I do remember that song.
That was her. That was her.
Oh my God, memories flooding back.
But the thing is, that was 98. That was 4 years earlier. This is teen pop we're talking about. If she hadn't had a second hit within 4 years, she was never gonna. I mean, I do kind of like the idea of a musical number just spontaneously erupting in a diner, and there's even some beats in that one that work for me, like the old ladies who suddenly become the horn section. That was neat. But the song itself just isn't quite catchy enough, and also, I'm sorry, I'm sure Jennifer Page is a nice person. She's just not a compelling enough performer to tie that whole scene together, so it just becomes another awkward scene in a movie full of them. Now, the one song that wasn't written by John Hyatt was the one performed by Brian Setzer, which was written by Brian Setzer, I'm Only In It for the Honey. And it's the only song in the movie that feels like it's not a previously existing song in this universe. Like, all the other songs, even though they're original, they're performed with the aesthetics of a jukebox musical, like the Blues Brothers, where, yeah, characters break in a song, but it's established that these songs exist in this universe as songs. This is the only song with the aesthetics of a conventional musical, where the lyrics are presented as basically sung dialogue.
Hey there, Mr. Fuzzy. Well, I guess that settles that. Leave your tour bus parked out front, and the keys are under the mat.
Oh, now hold on just a minute. Hold that jive, cause I can feel this middle about to come alive.
As much as I love John Hyatt, the Brian Setzer song is probably my favorite song and favorite scene in this movie. Maybe even a little more than the walk-in scenes, because it just has such a great pounding rockabilly energy to it. And the band is just giving it their all in that scene, especially on camera. Like, the drummer is just pure adrenaline.
I would reach the point where I would search the screen for things to look at that weren't the bears.
I don't blame you.
And the musicians were constantly rewarding you for paying attention to them. They were into it. Or at least they were faking it convincingly enough to be like, I'm enjoying watching you and not this monster in front of you.
Except for the scene in the hotel lounge, there is one musician who is so clearly checked out. Her face is this scowl, and yep, she's openly contemptuous that she's got to be there.
I know, it's great.
It's so great. Speaking of openly contemptuous, Elton John is in this movie.
He hates bears.
Another thing I didn't even mention in my video because I didn't know how to. It is quite possibly the most worthlessly random cameo from a megastar that I've ever seen in a movie. He doesn't do anything.
No.
I honestly think the joke is that it's supposed to be a misdirection. At that point, we've already seen those two big musical numbers erupt around random people encountering the bears and saying, "Oh my God, you're the Country Bears. I'm such a big fan. Let's do a musical number." And I think we're supposed to think that's going to happen with Elton John too. And he starts to say, "Hey, you're the Country Bears." And the bears just say, "Yeah, yeah, we know you're a big fan, but we're in a hurry. Sorry, gotta go." And they just leave. I think that's the joke they were going for. But the problem is Elton so clearly does not want to be there. He's just got such a contemptuous vibe for the whole operation. And he's saying every single one of his lines through gritted teeth. So at no point do we, the audience, actually buy that we might be getting an Elton John musical number out of this.
It's also a scene that would have worked with literally any famous musician.
Right, absolutely.
There's nothing Elton specific about the guy. Because the reveal is, oh, this is Elton John's house and Ted is just renting a room above the garage.
I'm kind of amazed they got someone as big as Elton John.
I have to imagine Elton showing up was largely just, hey, you owe Disney another favor because of something Lion King related.
Probably. By the way, a few years ago, Peter Hastings was on, I want to say, Rob Paulson's Talkin' Tunes podcast, and he told this amazing Elton John anecdote. So they're shooting Elton's cameo with the bears, and one of the bears starts malfunctioning. In particular, the bear's lower jaw starts drooping downward and to the side, and the bear just looks like, ah, and it looks really awkward. And Elton John quips, "Hey, it looks like me when I've had too much blow." Gotta love them. One more note about the songs they use in this. There's one scene early on where they use So You Wanna Be a Rock and Roll Star by the Byrds. Early on in the writing process for my review, I watched this movie with my mom. She, in real life, was actually pretty good friends for several years with Roger McGuinn, the frontman of the Byrds, who co-wrote So You Wanna Be a Rock and Roll Star. And I distinctly remember when that scene came up, she said, "Well, at least Roger made some money off this." That woman could find a silver lining in everything.
I will say that I love the detail in the brothers' side of the room, where there's a Limp Bizkit poster, another Limp Bizkit poster, and then a Nine Inch Nails poster. And before Soul came out,
right,
I was like, that's so awesome that there's a Nine Inch Nails reference in a Disney movie.
Yep. But now Trent Reznor's fucking scoring Disney movies.
Scoring a Disney movie.
Because when I think jazz, I think Trent Reznor.
Right.
Everyone knows the two biggest names in jazz are Trent Reznor and Ryan Gosling.
When Barry comes home, Stephen Tobolowsky sees him and screams,
"Hi, Dad!"
"Oh, Barry!"
And of course he screams because there's a fucking bear in the house. What the fuck? I don't know. Another thing I just noticed on this watch, right before the Diedrich Bader bear shows up at Barry's house.
"Dex, honey, would you get that?
Oh, God.
And tell Barry to come down for some pie."
"Barry! Pie."
Oh.
Berry pie.
Yeah.
Just noticed that.
I noticed that too. It's such a dumb pun with no attention drawn to it that...
Why would you notice it?
Why would you?
I was trying to work out in my head, was that supposed to be a pun or did they just not notice that it sounded like a type of pie?
I could believe either one. Another thing I want to mention for the crowd scene at the end at the big climactic concert at Country Bear Hall, the producers actually reached out to the then burgeoning online Disney park fan community.
Huh.
And some of the most prominent members of the fan community circa 2001-ish are extras in that crowd. I know Jim Hill is in there somewhere and Michelle Smith and Roger Colton. Especially a lot of bloggers from that era.
Wow.
Back when vlogs were just blogs.
This was when Disney had a positive relationship with the blogging community and wasn't just constantly debunking their rumors.
Or at least less negative.
Yeah.
So let's talk about why one would make this movie in the first place. What one would hope to appeal to for people who are fans of the attraction. Because the way I see it, if you're a fan of the Country Bear Jamboree, it's probably for one of three reasons. You're a fan of seeing impressive, groundbreaking animatronic shows happen in front of your eyes.
Right.
Which you don't get from the movie.
No.
You're a fan of the cute Mark Davis designs, which you don't get from the movie.
Correct.
Or you're a fan of the hokey old novelty country songs, which you don't get from the movie.
Yep.
I mean, the songs in this movie are great, but they're no Mama Don't Whoop Little Buford.
Mama don't whoop little Buford. Mama don't pound on his head. Mama don't whoop little Buford. I think you should shoot him instead.
The songs in the movie are good, but if you're trying to appeal to fans of the Country Bears, you want to have that blood on the saddle scene in there.
You really do. I think they just really wanted to have a soundtrack album they could sell, and they wanted that soundtrack to seem at least slightly legitimate, because they wanted to get that Oh Brother Where Art Thou money, I guess.
And again, if Eisner was really trying to start his own Muppets, and he was like, we own the Country Bears, let's do something with them, the Mark Davis designs of the Jamboree are much more Muppety than the Jim Henson designs of the movie.
They really are, and Mark Davis passed away a couple years before this came out, so it would have been a nice tribute.
He does get a special thanks in the credits.
He does.
He does, yeah, and I kind of don't know why, because the designs look nothing like his bears.
It was probably a contractual, like, legally he's the creator, but WGA-wise he's not the creator,
right,
so we have
right.
to give him some credit, but we can't say based on characters created by.
The special thanks segment of movie credits is just where you get in all those, okay, unions are preventing us from crediting you directly, but here's the other people who contributed to this shitpile.
Between this and the Mansion movie, it raises the question of how pirates managed to not only be good, but be a relatively faithful adaptation of the narrative-less ride that is Pirates of the Caribbean.
Honestly, two words, Jerry Bruckheimer. Say what you want about the dude, he understood if this movie's gonna work, we gotta hire these real writers, Ted Elliott and Terry Rossio, to yep. really make this love letter to old swashbucklers.
And then he defended them from yeah. too much studio interference.
Yeah, Eisner wanted to shut down that movie because it was getting too expensive, and of course this movie had just flopped, and Eisner almost canceled Pirates because he thought, eh, no one wants to see theme park movies.
Yes, the fuck we do.
And it was Bruckheimer who told him, look, do you know how much Lord of the Rings budget was? If you really want to compete with these guys, you've got to up the ante. By the way, another thing I just noticed on this viewing, I don't know how I missed it before, at the end of the movie, when the camera does that last long tracking shot out of Country Bear Hall and then pans up to the night sky, what do we see in the night sky?
Ursa Major.
The constellation Ursa Major, aka Big Bear.
Yep. I caught that because one of my favorite children's books growing up was The Big Dipper and You. Mm. So I will recognize the Big Dipper, aka the long tail of Ursa Major, as long as I live. What else would you end on?
You'd end on Diedrich Bader opening a cop car and water spilling out, apparently.
Yep.
Anyway, it is now time to answer that question that has been baffling mankind and bearkind through the ages, namely, what's the attraction? So, obviously, this was based on an attraction. It was based on the Country Bear Jamboree, which still exists at Frontierland and Walt Disney World, and Westernland at Tokyo Disneyland. No longer exists in Critter Country at Disneyland in Anaheim, was replaced by a Winnie the Pooh ride. But now that this is obviously going to be the most watched title on Disney Plus, because who doesn't want to watch Christopher Walken being a lunatic? Disney is going to say, oh shit, we really fucked up getting rid of Country Bear Jamboree at Disneyland. So how are they going to bring the Country Bears into the parks, Morgan?
Besides bringing back Country Bear Hall?
You know, in the parks, the hall was actually called Grizzly Hall. They changed it to Country Bear Hall for this movie. I don't know why.
Assuming they can't do that because Winnie the Pooh is a beloved children's classic.
Of course.
I don't know what happened to Barnum and Bailey, the circus, after it closed down, but find some of those trained performing bears. How hard can it possibly be to teach them to play the one string thing? It's only got one string.
What could possibly go wrong?
People can have photo ops.
Yeah.
With their kids.
Just let bears wander through the park.
Get a lot of good exercise out of doors.
It's a mall world after all.
We mock, but I would not put that past Bob Chapek.
No, Bob Chapek hates live entertainment. You know that.
Hey, bears aren't unionized.
That's true.
So
you can pay them in salmon.
Pay them in salmon and all the tourists they can catch.
Dave!
Clearly the flagship scene in this movie is the car wash scene.
Right.
Another attraction that already exists that was in part influenced by car washes The boulder scene in Indy, Tony Baxter famously took inspiration from seeing the car wash move to figure out how he would do the rolling back effect in Indy.
It's brilliant.
So they're just going to replace the dangling Indy with a flying Diedrich Bader and Chill Mitchell.
I love it.
Charlie.
Well, Tony, it is rather simple. Country Bear Jamboree already exists in Florida at this moment in time.
Mm-hmm.
So you just hover a gigantic anvil over it. And the attraction is to push a button.
Oh, yeah.
Crush it and have you say,
"Oh, no! Country Bear Hall has been crushed!"
But then you wait 6 to 8 months for them to rebuild it so you can do it all over again.
Yay!
Yay! Well, unfortunately, you're all wrong.
Dang it.
Aw.
I think it's pretty obvious what the attraction is here. I mean, the guys in Aerosmith ain't getting any younger.
Oh!
They're gonna retheme the rock and roller coaster to the Country Bear coaster, and it's gonna be the exact same ride, except right in the middle, they douse everyone with honey.
I love it.
And you're stuck to your seat forever.
You know, I can't see how that would go wrong in Florida.
I approve.
So, final verdict, everyone, is the Country Bears a Disney Plus or a Disney Minus? Charlie?
You know, I said that there wasn't enough chaotic energy to make up for, like, all the real world stuff that they tried to inject into it. That being said, there is still the perfect amount of that chaotic energy for me to say Disney Plus. I love the hell out of this movie. It is just dumb fun all the way through.
Dave, Disney Plus or Disney Minus?
Disney Plus for the Alex Rocco gag and the Christopher Walken scenes. Disney Minus for all the parts I fast forward through between all those scenes.
You gotta pick one or the other. Don't allow centrist fence sitters.
I will give it a very tepid Disney Plus because I do appreciate how weird it is, and I have a lot of respect for the people involved for having to deal with everything they had to deal with. The fact that it is basically watchable is a massive achievement.
Yes.
It really is.
The good parts for me are so much better than they have any right to be. The bad parts are exactly as bad as you expect them to be. And the mediocre parts are like just a few tweaks away from being good.
That's a good way of putting it.
So I will give it a tepid Disney Plus, even though I don't exactly recommend it to people who aren't fascinated by this type of movie.
Morgan, Disney Plus or Disney Minus?
I'm sorry, guys. This is a Disney Minus for me.
That's okay.
No, that's valid.
On one hand, I love this movie for the fact that it brought all of us together. I'm fascinated by the behind the scenes and how something like this happens and doesn't happen and what goes right and what goes wrong. Credit where it's due. They tried so hard to make this work. And the fact that it was just not going to work is not their fault. If you're really fascinated by bad movies, this might be your jam. If you've got a bad movie night with friends, this will slay them. But if you're anyone else watching for any reason at all, pick something else.
I will say, Morgan, you should definitely track down the DVD and watch the commentary. I think you really would enjoy that.
I'm certain I would. I would find that so much more entertaining than I found the actual movie.
You know, Peter, I don't remember too many bears on your crew. What was that all about?
I had as many as I could get.
Yeah, right. Quotas. I get it.
I love it when someone really talented decides they're going to save a sinking ship by just turning it into a submarine and heading for the bottom. We're going to crater this thing, and it's going to be hilarious.
You know, I fully admit that objectively, this movie is mostly garbage, but God damn it, it's my garbage.
Yes.
It's your garbage, God damn it.
I don't pretend to be objective on this show. Never have, never will. It's a fool's errand. And honestly, if not for this movie, I'm not sure I'd be doing this podcast today. I've gotten a lot of mileage out of making fun of this piece of shit. So just for what it's done for me, I gotta say Disney Plus. I was down on it in the video, but in the last 10 years, my mind has changed. I'm just way too attached to it now to possibly give it a Disney minus.
I did give it a Disney minus, but that does not mean it's not a beloved personal artifact for me.
Of course.
And I will probably put it on whenever I want to be reminded of you guys.
Aww.
Because if you're listening to this in the future, we're still in the plague times, and our squad has not been able to assemble in person for almost a year now. I won't deny it. It gets to me sometimes. It's good to hold on to things that are important to you personally and sort of just forget what everyone else thinks.
Well, you know what we have to do once everything gets back to normal, right? We gotta get the band back together!
Get the band back together!
Uh-huh. Oh, okay, fine. From the bottom of my heart, thank you, Country Bears. And thank you to everyone out there who ever watched Some Jerk with a Camera in the last 10 years. It's been a hell of a ride, even if it kind of stopped short halfway through. And I've just been kind of resting on the laurels of Some Jerk with a Camera these last few years. I might get back to it someday. We'll see. But thanks for a great 10 years, guys. And before we get to plugs, I just want to tell this one last story about the Country Bears, this one anecdote I heard, which kind of sums up everything you need to know about the movie. This is a story I heard Colin Mockery tell on a live stream once because Diedrich Bader had told it to him. So it's several times removed, so who knows how much of this is true. But the story is, Diedrich Bader and Christopher Walken were sitting side by side in the makeup room. I'm not sure why that would have happened because they didn't actually have any scenes together. Maybe it was for a scene that got cut, I don't know. It was towards the end of the shoot, and Diedrich asks, just making conversation, "So Chris, what other projects have you got lined up after this?" And Walken replies, "Oh, well, next I'm doing the new Spielberg movie, Catch Me If You Can, with Tom Hanks and Leonardo DiCaprio." And Diedrich's like, "Wow, that's a hell of a leap. You're going straight from the Country Bears movie to working with Spielberg, Tom Hanks, and Leo DiCaprio." And Walken just turns to him and says, "Well, they're both good scripts." There you have it, folks. They're both good scripts.
That's all, folks.
That's all. Bears! So who's got stuff to plug?
Follow me on Twitter, TheWire2. I do still have a YouTube channel, technically, but I haven't uploaded there for a while.
All of my links are at doggins.com, doggans.com. Links to all my social medias, links to my YouTube that has my videos, links to my Patreon where you can give me money, and just all the links you could ask for.
You can find my channel on YouTube under the name Theme Snark and Friends. And I'm under basically all of my social media accounts as @ThemeSnark. And related to Tony's second ever episode of Some Jerk with a Camera, I too have started my own historical retrospective series on California Adventure. The first episode is on my channel right now, and it is the first in a series of 5 videos that I hope to have finished by the end of the year, but no promises.
And as always, you can follow me on Twitter at Tony Goldmark, and you can also follow this show on Twitter at EFVD Podcast. I've also got a Facebook fan group you can join called Some Jerk with a Fan Club, and I've got a YouTube channel, youtube.com/Tony Goldmark, where you can find all 3 seasons of Some Jerk with a Camera, including that very first Country Bears episode that we've been jabbering about this whole time, along with a bunch of other videos about movies and theme parks, and even a few scant episodes of this very podcast. You can find every episode of this podcast at pipedreampodcast.com, as well as all the usual outlets like iTunes, Spotify, and Google Play. If you like what you've been hearing and you'd like to help us out, please subscribe, please leave a review, please give us 5 stars. All that stuff helps us get discovered by the almighty algorithm. If you'd like to help us out even more, you can donate to my Patreon, patreon.com/Tony Goldmark, where if you pledge any amount, even the bare minimum of $1 a month, you get to hear episodes of this podcast one day early on Tuesdays instead of Wednesdays. Even on weeks when I don't quite have the episode finished by Tuesday, like... this week, but in my defense, this was my longest episode ever, I still release a work-in-progress version of what I've got so far to my patrons on Tuesday, so you get something from me every Tuesday, no matter what. Once again, that's patreon.com/TonyGoldmark. Special thanks to all my patrons. You don't know how much it means to me, especially in these financially uncertain times. And now, as promised at the very beginning of the show, a special announcement about the near future of this podcast and how you can help choose what we cover next month. This is actually something I wanted to do last year, but then the coronavirus hit and we went on hiatus for 5 months and that fucked up the schedule, so we're doing it now. March will be a theme month on Escape from Walt Disney. For all 5 episodes we release in March, we will be feeding a special shortlist into the randomizer containing only Disney Plus titles that adhere to a specific theme. And what theme will that be? Well, that's up to you folks. Right now, on the official Escape from Walt Disney Twitter feed at EFED Podcast, you lovely listeners can vote on which theme you want to hear us cover. And since we're doing this in March, we're doing the poll March Madness style. I'm talking 4 polls, 1 Twitter thread, 16 potential themes to choose from. You have until 11:59 p.m. Pacific time on Sunday, February 7th, to vote for your favorites in each bracket. And then next week, all 4 winners face off in 1 final poll to determine our champion. Once again, those polls can be found on the at EFVD podcast Twitter feed, or you can access them directly by typing in tinyurl.com/EFVDpoll21. So go vote now. In the meantime, Dave, you still have a guest choice option. Would you like to come back next week and use it, or keep it in your back pocket?
I'm still keeping it in my back pocket because I want to build up as much anticipation as possible for what will inevitably be a giant letdown.
He's keeping it in his back pocket for the giant letdown, folks. Thanks so much for being on the show, Dave. That means we are finally back to using the randomizer to determine next week's topic. It's been a while since we actually used the randomizer on this show, hasn't it? Let's correct that right now with some help from one of my guests on next week's episode, Cassie Shima. How you doing, Cassie?
Oh, I'm doing okay. Thanks for asking.
Are you ready to read off the randomizer's pick for next week?
Alrighty.
Okay, Smart House, initiate random shuffle mode, please.
Initiating random shuffle mode.
Make a selection.
And the winner is
Earth Live from 2017.
Earth Live, is that a National Geographic thing? Let me look that up.
I have just as much of an idea as you, Tony Goldmark.
That is a National Geographic documentary from 2017 that's an hour and a half long.
Oh boy.
Okay, join us next week on Escape from Walt Disney when we will cover the 2017 National Geographic special, Earth Live.
Come on home, where your video's playing. Good times are waiting, it's true. Come where your family is waiting for Walt Disney and you. Walt Disney and you. Walt Disney and you.
Until next time, I'm some jerk with a camera.